Hi, my name is Amy and I love pancakes. But I don't love pancakes indiscriminately. I love the pancakes I remember as a child. Hot, fluffy frisbees of cake waiting to be smothered in butter and drenched in maple syrup. There's a few food chemistry secrets behind making great pancakes. And in this video today, we'll show you what those food chemistry secrets are to making fluffy pancakes. What you learn today in this video will help you not just with making beautiful pancakes, but will also help you when you want to make biscuits, muffins, and cakes. Pancakes, along with cookies, biscuits, cakes, and other things like that, are known as chemically leavened. This is because you use chemicals, such as baking soda or baking powder, to create carbon dioxide gas that fill your batter with air and make your baked goods light and fluffy. Carbon dioxide gas is created when I add an acid to a base. Here you see that I have a box of baking soda, which is a base, and here I have a bottle of vinegar, which is an acid. What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to pour a little bit of this baking soda, the base, into this bowl. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a little bit of vinegar to the base so you can see the carbon dioxide gas is being created. This is the same exact chemical reaction that we want to have in our pancakes, except without the vinegar taste. Now that we understand what chemical leavening is, let's go ahead and assemble the ingredients that we'll need for making pancakes. On this side, the wet ingredients, we're going to use milk, butter, this is not wet yet, but we're going to melt it, yogurt, and eggs. On the dry side, we have our friends, baking soda and baking powder, which will create the chemical leavening. We have flour, all-purpose flour, and we've got a nice bag of sugar. Now that we've assembled our ingredients, we're going to go ahead and create the batter. With chemically leavened foods, you always want to keep your wet stuff separate from your dry stuff until you're actually ready to cook because of that chemical reaction that happens so quickly. Here I have two bowls. One is smaller, and we'll use this for the wet ingredients. One is bigger, and we'll use this for the dry. We'll start by adding 1.5 cups of flour. What kind of flour should you use? Well, in this case, I want to use either all-purpose flour or cake flour. If you end up using bread flour to make pancakes, it's really meant to be used with yeast as your leavening product, not chemical leavening, and your pancakes will turn out to be tough and rubbery. So I'm using 1.5 cups of regular all-purpose flour, and you'll see I'm not measuring very carefully. Don't need to measure very carefully with pancakes. So I'm just going to guesstimate here. That looks like 1.5 cups. Great, we've added our flour. Next, we will add 2 tablespoons of sugar. Sugar can help your pancakes have a tender crumb and keep it moist. But sugar isn't tremendously important in this recipe, so we're just gonna add 2 tablespoons. The third step is the trickiest, adding it the right kind and amount of chemical leavening ingredients to make our pancakes light and fluffy. We have 2 choices here. We can either add baking soda, as I discussed, and or baking powder. Since most people don't know the difference between the two, let's go ahead and talk about that for just a second. When you use baking soda in your baking, you must always have an acid to kick off that chemical reaction that creates the bubbles. Today, we're going to be using yogurt as an acid. Some other types of acids that you can use when you're using baking soda are lemon juice, yogurt, buttermilk. Buttermilk pancakes will be using buttermilk as the acid to counterbalance the base, the baking soda. Another option is our friend, the baking powder. Now, baking powder works differently than baking soda does. Rather than reacting to an acid that you have to add to the batter, such as adding yogurt, baking powder is actually an all-in-one product. It contains everything you need to create the chemical reaction right in this little canister. Well, let me show you. I'm going to add a little bit of baking powder to this dish right here. And then I'm going to walk over to the sink and I'm going to add some hot water. And you can see that that chemical reaction is happening just as we saw with the baking soda. The difference is that baking powder is often double acting, and double acting means it reacts right now when it's introduced to moisture, and it will react a second time when we're cooking the batter. Today we will add both baking soda and baking powder to our mix. Now, as we discussed, I can add baking powder all by itself. It doesn't need anything to help make it work. Baking soda, however, needs an acid, of course, to start that chemical reaction. In general, if you're going to use both products in your baked good, you want to have about 3 parts baking powder to 1 part baking soda. So I'm going to go ahead and add 3 teaspoons of baking powder to my mix here, my dry mix. 1, 2, 3, and a little bit less than a teaspoon of baking soda. Just remember that every time you use baking soda, you're going to need to add an acid to the mix in order to set off that chemical reaction. That does it for our dry ingredients. We're going to mix this dry set of ingredients very, very carefully because we want our leavening ingredients equally distributed throughout the flour mixture. We don't want any little pockets of baking soda or baking powder hanging out. We want them to be well distributed in our flour mix. Generally speaking, you want to match the amount of wet ingredients to dry. We added 1.5 cups of flour to our dry flour mixture, so we're going to add the same amount of wet ingredients. To begin, I'm going to add 1 cup of soy milk. You can use dairy milk or soy milk. In this case, I'm using soy. This is 1/2 cup measure, so I'm going to add 2 of these. And then the other thing is that because we used baking soda as one of our chemical leavening agents, I need to have an acid to kick off that chemical reaction. Yogurt is going to be our acid in this case. So I'm going to go ahead and scoop out 1/2 cup of that and add it to my mix. We will next add 2 large eggs to our wet batter. Eggs serve as binders and hold all of the batter together. Lastly, we will add 3 tablespoons of melted butter. Butter, of course, adds a delicious taste and aroma to just about everything, but it also coats the proteins in the flour and waterproofs them, thereby protecting them from forming gluten, which is what makes doughs tough and stringy and chewy, which is not what we want in our pancakes. I'm going to go ahead and take this 3 tablespoons of butter and put it over in a pan and turn it on, and we'll just wait for that to melt. Get you my frying pan. Completely melted, and I'm going to go ahead and take it and add it to my wet mixture. We're going to keep going with this, and I'm going to go ahead and stir the wet ingredients well together. Make sure that all of the wet ingredients, the milk, the butter, the eggs, and the yogurt in our case, are well mixed. The next step will be adding the wet ingredients to the dry ingredients. We're now ready to add the wet ingredients to the dry ingredients. remember that once we do this, the chemical reaction starts. So we want to make sure that we're ready to go and ready to cook the pancakes before we actually mix the wet and the dry. So I'm going to go ahead and make sure that the stove is on. And I'm going to set it for about medium heat. All right, so we're ready to add the wet ingredients to the dry ingredients. And the way that we're going to do this is we're just going to slowly add the wet to the dry. And the key here is not to mix everything super thoroughly. You still are going to see bits of batter that haven't been thoroughly mixed. And you want to be really gentle with this. So what we're going to do is we're just going to cut it down the middle and then gently kind of fold the dry ingredients over the top. Cut down the middle, fold the dry ingredients over the top, and I'm just going to kind of spin the bowl as I do this until we get things kind of lightly mixed together, but we're not going to be very harsh in our mixing here because what that's going to do is it's going to force all the air bubbles out of the batter. We still see lumps in our batter, but this is about where we want it. We're now ready to start cooking our pancakes. Before we try the first one, however, let's make sure the pan is hot enough. I'm going to scoop up a little bit of water and sprinkle it in the pan. You can see that it cooks and bubbles immediately upon impact, which means that that pan is hot enough. If the water evaporates immediately upon the water hitting it, your pan is too hot. We're ready to start cooking our pancakes. What I've got here is a batter and half a cup or a third of a cup scoop. And I'm just going to go ahead and scoop some of this into the pan. Your pancakes should spread out evenly. Once it's in the pan, you basically want to leave it alone to cook. You can kind of adjust. If it's not coming out in a perfect circle and that's important to you, you can adjust a little bit in the pan. But generally speaking, once it's in the pan and starting to cook, you just want to sort of leave it alone. After a minute or two, you should start to see bubbles appearing and popping on the surface of the pancake. Once you see those bubbles appearing and popping on the surface of the pancake, you can flip the pancake over. Once you flip the pancake, again, leave it alone. If you pat or press down on it, you will push out the carbon dioxide bubbles, and your pancake will not be as fluffy as it could have been. After another minute or two, go ahead and take the pancakes off the heat, put them on a plate, and you're ready to enjoy them.